afternoon. I welcome you all today for a very special session of AdvoTechCord Tech Talk, where we will be discussing some important facts and details about metal composite panels and their properties. Today, I have with me Kolkata's very own architect Ayan Sen, who is a designer of national repute. Ayan Sen has an undergraduate degree from CEPT Ahmedabad and his master's from MIT Cambridge. Ayan is a visiting faculty in some of the leading colleges across the country like CEPT Ahmedabad, Kamala Raheja Mumbai, IIT Kharagpur, to name a few. Winner of several regional and national awards, Ayan's works are featured in various architectural magazines and journals across the country. He believes that a small studio can produce a cutting-edge project matching to global standards. Ayan Sen dabbles with design issues pertaining to critical regionalism along with functionalism. That means, at one hand, he is creating villas, resorts and conservation projects, and on the other hand, he is creating medical facilities, industrial factories and those kind of works at the same level, which means his range of work is diverse and there's a huge platform from which he's operating from. Ayan Sen has been using metal composite panels for quite some time, and today we are going to hear from him his own experience, his views about this product. Welcome Ayan to the AdvoTechCord Tech Talk today. How are you?
Very well, thank you very much. It's always a pleasure to catch up with you.
So I'm going to start off with my questions. So tell me Ayan, when do you choose metal facades for your projects?
Well, metal facades is a very important material to consider in our practice in the contemporary architectural language. I think the whole idea of uniformity, speed of execution, the way you can detail a facade, mix and match the surfaces, that's the time I would choose a metal facade. I think I've also used metal facades in a lot of revitalization projects. I think inner city architecture demands a whole bunch of facade revitalization, and what metal facades offer essentially is a quick way in which we can transform the entire face of a building, of course in the right design paradigm, and then also you know, trying to get a sense of control on your execution quality. Sometimes it's slow. There's a lot of weathering in certain natural materials at times, particularly in an area such as Kolkata, hot, humid, a lot of rains. So stone is not a preferred choice unless you really want to really want to use stone for certain reasons. So I think in such situations, metal facades offer a lot of character, and I think some of the contemporary metal facades, particularly the Wabi Sabi series, which I'm very fond of, using, you know, that gives natural copper tone or patina tones and things like that. So that really engages with the landscape or the context, depending on where things are. So yeah, I think in specific cases, metal facade is a first choice.
So you were saying that stone is really not the right material for a city like Kolkata?
No, I don't think so. But it's in a hot, humid climate. I mean, of course, it's not. It's a great material to use in projects. In Kolkata context, I would honestly use in a situation where, by and large, the budget of the project often restricts us to use good quality textured paint, which has ways of reusing over the years, repainting. So that's always a big positive in terms of cost. But when it comes to a corporate building, when it comes to a sense of identity, metal facades allow a certain uniformity, and with the variations in terms of texture that metal facades offer these days, I think that, of course, you have to choose it right, and that's the job of the designer. If you choose a wrong material or it looks tacky, it's a problem. And it's important that the metal facade aspect is used in the right details, but not stuck to the building. You know, junction details are right. Often metal facades had created a problem because of the way the silicon junctions are, and that could sort of create patches or create leakage points, and sort of color would fade out over time. So that's a wrong way of using the facade. So I think the important thing about metal facade is how do you, the fixing detail happens, and how the junction is made, how the facade can breathe in its own. So that's important too, which is not just the material, but actually the way it's used, not only in terms of aesthetics, also technology.
What would you say about the colors? Like metal facades or metal panels, they come with a coating, right? So what would be your experience about colors, textures,
I am a bit fond of textures and not pretty shiny surfaces. Maybe it's a set of projects that I handle in my practice so far. I think I've used the Wabi Sabi series in a project to give it that copper, the cotton steel look, the copper look, or in the case of my Tata project, the use of steel and the grays and the tones of gray that it offers. I think in these projects, the metal facade really expresses the design intent in the appropriate way.
For Tata Steel also, you had used a Wabi Sabi antique slate color.
Right. So the whole slate and the metal language helped me to contrast it with the whole use of steel and tubular systems. And actually, another project that we are revitalizing currently, we had to convert the entire building in a very short time. And we kind of figured out that the right choice would be this whole cotton steel. I mean, I would have obviously preferred to use cotton steel very honestly, but you know, the metal facade offered a great alternative in the cotton steel look. And of course, the choice on the taste of it has to be right. And it's actually used technically also in an appropriate way without any sealants. It has it fixes an overlapping system, and there is a whole breathing gap between the back surface and the front surface. So I think that's workmanship is of course very important. And one of the options and choices of metal facade is it's put up by trained personnel, hopefully. Hopefully you guys are training. And I think that really makes a big difference in terms of the quality of implementation. I think we all dream a lot, but when it comes to implementing, the right kind of implementation really makes a big difference. And I think metal facades offer that technology and the workmanship that the teams trained can certify and do. So that makes a whole bunch of difference.
Can you share with us some important properties of metal composites?
I think the speed of execution is a very important aspect. The fact that it doesn't vary unnecessarily in terms of its and it doesn't wear off over time. So I think there's a certain time-sensitive parameter here. And of course, if the sealant is right and if it's a wrong sealant, the whole thing will go wrong. But I think that allows it to have, it's got the coating character of it also. It provides a certain thermal insulation also at some level if you have that right air gap. And a certain thickness and certain gauge when it's used, it allows, at least for exterior cladding purposes, it allows almost a certain way in which it could kind of prevent the building surface from getting heated. So that's another very important property, I think, which we can sort of use. Of course, there are many cladding materials would offer the same thing, but what metal facade, at least certain right kind of facade would do is it has a certain system in which sort of comes together. So I think the importance is to sort of not just stick on without thinking, but actually to work the way in which it comes together.
I would like to pick up an important question that is becoming a global concern currently, which is fire safety. There are various codes that is being created and formed, and there are various fire safety products that is there in the market now. So what are your views about that?
Well, I think obviously fire safety is one of the most important life safety code in a project, and I think obviously there's a combustible quality in any facade for that matter. So it's important that how we are using a facade, is it a complete sealed dead facade? We have obviously fire escape points, openability, these are very important aspects of design per se. If the facade, I would definitely take a choice of a 2 year, 2 hour rated facade, which is one of your series I know of, the A2 series I guess, which must be used in projects where there is a certain fire hazard component used. And of course, fire issues are important, but you have to actually design your openings and your escape routes based on that. Because in case of fire, it should not have a combustible property that immediately catches fire. And of course, a sealant has a tendency to catch, which is why I tend to avoid sealants in the first place. Because you have a non-sealant joint which has a sort of lock-on system which allows the facade to have an interlock and actually start seeing the groove instead of trying to sort of put up plastic and literally seal the facade. The sealant is the first thing that gets, catches fire, it gets damaged. So I am a strong proponent of using the lock-on system so that not only will you see the groove, but it also prevents a fire hazard from sort of taking place. As far as the fire issue is concerned,
any facade can catch fire. So if you have a 2R rating, I think that's kind of okay to go with.
Tell me, Arun, did you ever feel that while explaining to a fabricator or an engineer that the right way or the accurate way that you want the panels to be fitted, cladding, was there like any kind of miscommunication that happened and they didn't understand, or maybe they are not equipped to understand how to fit a metal cladding?
Yeah, I think it's a common problem. I experienced this problem once for sure. I think the important issue here is that one needs to sort of really specify your groove lines at certain points so you know exactly how your facades are coming together.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not the difficult part. I would assume that at least that's taken quite seriously and it's implemented. But also how the grooves come together. I mean, sometimes sealants are used very casually. In one project of mine, and in many cases for that matter, sealants are very casually put. So I think the workforce by and large and your trained personnel in your company and the down channel partners need to be trained to put facades together in the right way and not sort of just somehow jam it with sealants, which ultimately spoil the entire facade of the building. And I think the importance of putting a facade, which is the starting point, which is the ending point, where the residue should be left, what are my critical parameters, have to be very strongly defined. Otherwise, it's not something that you start from one end and finish somewhere else, and whatever is left behind, you sort of somehow put a seal in. That's not, and that's exactly why a lack of implementation can downgrade the quality of the product. So any product for that matter in architecture finishes. How you're actually applying it becomes important. It goes for a paint also, for mm-hmm. a decade. So the workmanship, implementation are the hidden details which needs supervision. Our practice does that from ground up and specifies and makes sure that each junction is as accurate as possible. So yeah.
So you are trying to say that more of the right information has to go through to the engineers and the fabricators. They need to understand that what exactly or what is the exact way of cladding a metal facade.
Yeah, it needs to go not only from architectural practices. I mean, we send it as a theme. We do a whole lot of drawings and we are pretty detailed about our execution planning. But I think it's also important that the entire workforce is trained by manufacturing companies of how, what are the best ways to fix and what are the strict no-nos. And I think that would enable the right information dissemination even at the workforce level. So I think your product, you know, we are using it in corporate buildings in Kolkata. The Tata Interior has used it in my case and some signages of designer stores. But it's also used actually by the masses. I mean, sometimes in the right way, sometimes the wrong way. But I think the larger impact would change. And I'm a strong believer in sort of lifting the average up. It's not how well I specify in two of my select projects, but how everybody specifies in all of their projects. And that sort of would have a sort of a macro effect on facades by and large.
So you think having a handbook or a manual from the industry, from the manufacturer, do you think some kind of handbook will help?
Yeah, of course it will help. It will help us architects at one level, but we have to make a much more user-friendly manual for the workforce in regional languages, so that people know how to put it together, because I think that skill has to develop at the grassroots level of vendors who put together. A very strong, sophisticated manual may not necessarily help the guy on the, you know, as a lower end channel partner to put something together in a class C Indian city or tier 3, tier 4 Indian city. I think that's where your market is very strong, and if it's poorly used, you will have a legacy of ugly metal facades.
Does the size of panels becomes a problem, or do you adjust them in accordance to the wind load while designing the project?
We adjust, just, you know, keeping the wind load factor in mind. We also adjust actually based on the proportions of the panel. So it's a bit of both. I mean, obviously, if the panel is a very long panel in certain cases, which I have not personally experienced, but I think the importance is to sort of have the right proportion and in terms of the groove and in terms of where the lines are. So, you know, one has to factor in a certain amount of wastage, because I'm myself in my practice is pretty concerned about where my lines and my groove lines would be. But I think essentially it's a matter of the right choice of proportion and what size you would like to use. And even if it's a longer size and there's a wind load factor, one would, you know, use enough bracing members to sort of make sure that it's stuck on and there is a certain degree of capability of taking the new load. So yeah. And on a high-rise project, which I have not personally used, I think one has to sort of factor in the wind load factor very seriously, and it has to have a situation where there is enough wind flow through it instead of sort of catching onto it and so that it tends to fall off or something. But I think with the right fitment systems, that can be prevented for sure.
Tell me, Aaron, you have been using metal facades for quite some time, like metal panels and all.
Well, quite some time, but in some key projects, of course.
Some key projects, yeah.
Yes, I have new shapes.
Thank you so much for sharing with us and giving us the your plans that you do look forward to using metal facades in the future also.
Yeah, super. And pleasure talking to Aruna.
So as I come to the end of today's session, and as I was mentioning in the beginning that I have a very special announcement to make, that is Aludecor has launched its own technical manual. Volume 1 has been launched, which gives a basic idea of metal composite panels and its various usages across facades and interiors. This book comprises of the mechanical and chemical properties of metal composite panels, and this book will also assist engineers and fabricators in understanding facade design. So whatever we have discussed today in the episode is there in this book. And in future, as we get more reviews and questions from the industry, we will be coming out with the volume 2 of this book. Any kind of reviews are welcome from the viewers. You can mail us at info@greataludecor.com. And to know more about our panels, our products and the company, you can log into www.aludecor.com. So I thank Aaron Singh once again for being with us today, and I thank all of you for staying with us. Thank you so much. Goodbye.